But there's also the preparation of the gospel, and that's important. And so we've asked Pastor Steve Owens to minister to us on the preparation of the gospel. Come on, Pastor Steve.
Praise the Lord.
So give him a big hand of applause. Praise the
Lord, everybody.
Even though he's got hair. But he's got a gray beard.
Yes, I went to the barber the other day, and I told him to cut out all the gray. This is all that I left. That's good, but that's a sign of wisdom, right?
I've heard that.
Sign of experience, I guess, maybe? I don't know. Well, God is good anyhow. I'm going to say amen.
Amen.
It's good to be here in San Antonio, Pastor Jerry and First Lady Jeanette. Can we just give them a big hand?
Yeah.
What all goes into this. We were in Lincoln a year ago, and so we just appreciate all of you being here. I appreciate my fellow ministers of the gospel. It's good to see Uncle Jerry and Aunt Sandy.
Amen.
I think most of you know them. They're missionaries to Guatemala and Ecuador, and so anytime we can see them and go to monocles, it's a good thing.
Amen.
But I understand you guys don't have monocles down here, so we'll just... Well, you hear the church. Is that all right? We'd like to eat. How many would say amen?
Amen.
I shared with our church Sunday morning this little saying, and I thought I would share it with you here today. It's entitled, The Difference Between Life and School. The Difference Between Life and School. In school, you're taught a lesson and then given a test. In life, you're given a test that teaches you a lesson.
Right.
How many can say amen to that?
Amen.
How many know life has a way of humbling us?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Life has a way of kind of changing our priorities, so to speak. But I appreciate God's faithfulness in our life. I'm glad that my wife Debbie's here with us, and my associate pastor Josh and Christina. Appreciate them, fellow ministers of the gospel. Dad and Mom, Oscar and Carly Owens, they send their regards to everyone. They are doing fairly well health-wise. 6 years ago, when Debbie and I took over as lead pastors, we kind of made Dad our bishop, and he's still ministering. In fact, we left Sunday afternoon as well, and so Dad preached for us Sunday night, and I got the word that he went an hour and a half. So he hasn't lost a thing, has he? And somebody said, well, they'll be happy to get you back, and I said, exactly, that's why I had him preach. In fact, back in Lincoln at FGDC this year, we are celebrating 40 years of ministry.
Praise the Lord.
Mom and Dad came to Lincoln in 1977, and I was just 8 years old at the time, so if you do the math, that makes me 38. That's common core math right there. Right? But I had no idea that someday, you know, the Lord would call us a pastor, and it's very humbling. And so it's a special year for us, and we're just thankful for God's goodness and grace and mercy. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Turn with me, if you would, please, to the book of Ephesians, the 6th chapter. That's where we're going to find our opening text this morning. How many are thankful for the Word of God?
Amen.
Amen.
Right. Ephesians chapter 6. Just want to say that I really enjoyed the Word last night by Pastor David Cook, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
It was just, wow, that's exactly what I needed. And so the Lord knows exactly what we need, exactly when we need it. Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 10. We find the Apostle Paul here speaking to the church at Ephesus and says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Everybody say his might.
His might.
It's really important there. Not our strength, not our might, not our ability, but his might. Verse number 11, put on the whole armor. Everybody say the whole armor.
Whole armor.
Not some, not most, but put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Right.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. How many know sometimes we think our enemy is that saint that won't behave, that causes us a bunch of trouble, but how many know we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We've already been talking about that this morning. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you are able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, that we can come into your house and be with your people, but most of all, Lord, to be in your presence. Father, it's in your presence that there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Father, we're thankful that your word says where two or three are gathered in your name, you are in the midst. And Lord, it's obviously that we've already felt and enjoyed your Spirit, your power, your presence, your anointing. We ask you just to anoint our ears to hear, our hearts to receive. May the word of God fall on good ground this morning, and may we not just be hearers only, but may we be doers of your word as well. Hide me behind the cross, and may I speak only what you would have me to speak, and we give you all the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
And amen. Once again, Paul says in verse number 14, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on, notice that, having on, not just in your possession, but having on the breastplate of righteousness. Amen. Today I've been assigned to speak to you concerning the breastplate of righteousness. Can we say that together? The breastplate of righteousness. Now, when we consider a breastplate and its position on the body and its function as a piece of armor, we then quickly realize the importance of this piece of the armor of God. The breastplate is in a position, or it's put on, in order to protect the vital organs of the body. We all know that you can live without an arm. You can live without a leg. You can survive without certain body parts. But how many understand this morning, you cannot live unless your core is intact.
That's true.
Unless your core is intact, and that's where we're going today. We can't live without our heart.
Right.
We can't minister without our heart.
Amen.
How many's tried to do ministry without your heart?
Yeah.
We've all done there. Been there, done that. It's ugly, isn't it? But as Christians, we must realize that we can't live without our hearts being protected. How many know that as a child of God, we must learn how to guard our hearts?
Mm-hmm.
Guard our anointing.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
You see, our hearts are so valuable. Our hearts are valuable, but yet they are vulnerable. Look what Jesus said about the heart here in Luke chapter 6. Luke 6:45. A good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth that which is good. And an evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, brings forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. So here we see Jesus telling us that the things which are in our hearts are eventually going to come to the surface. And we're all living testimonies of that. How many would say amen?
Amen.
If enough pressure is applied, the contents of our heart will be revealed. Now, we know what the Bible tells us about our heart. The Bible tells us that the heart of man is desperately wicked. Desperately wicked. And that isn't to discourage us. That is just to remind us that we're very much human. How many are very much human here today? Let me get my hands, my elbows, my ankles. I'm very much human. But thank God for His grace and mercy. How many would say amen? Our hearts are desperately wicked. And that is why we must allow God to put a new heart within us. And that is done through what? Biblical salvation. But after the heart transplant has taken place, and we have a new heart, then we must learn how to guard that heart. Because again, I say the heart is valuable, but yet it's vulnerable. And that is where the importance of the breastplate is revealed. Now, I'm sure every speaker today is going to get up here and explain or share how their piece of the armor is the most important, and rightfully so. But I don't know how we can survive without the breastplate. I don't know how we can make it without the breastplate guarding our hearts. Proverbs chapter 4, verse number 23, look at this. It says, keep.
Yeah.
Keep your heart. How?
Right.
With all diligence. For out of it. In other words, out of the heart come the issues of life.
Yeah.
It was so eloquently spoken last night. As Christians, if we don't daily renew our hearts and our minds,
right.
then we're not going to make it, church.
That's true.
Come on.
Remember the scripture, you did run well, but what does hinder you that you should not obey the truth? How many know it's not how we start, but it's how we finish?
Amen.
How many want to hear him say, well done?
Amen.
Amen. How many know he's not going to say it unless we've done well? But our hearts are so valuable, yet so vulnerable. Our hearts are linked to so many things. Out of our hearts come our emotions and the real us. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 6, verse number 21. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. How many know our hearts have a way of connecting with things? Mm-hmm. Things that we should connect with and some things that we should not connect with. How many understand our hearts cannot be detached from the choices we make?
Yeah.
When we're not feeling it, we'll make statements like this. Well, my heart wasn't in it.
Yeah.
Right? We've all said that?
Right.
But the truth is, our heart goes where our mind takes us.
Yeah.
We can't separate our heart from the rest of our body. Proverbs chapter 3, verse number 5, it says this, trust in the Lord with some of.
No.
Most of.
No.
On the good day.
No.
No, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not into your own understanding. If you're like me, you try to figure things out, don't you? You try to figure out where God's going next. How many know it doesn't work that way? We walk by faith and not by sight. The Bible says the just shall live by faith. Amen.
Amen.
So it all goes back to trusting God. Do we trust Him? I preached a message one time entitled, An Unknown God Cannot Be Trusted. How many know if we really don't know Him, we're not going to trust Him with our lives?
Amen.
Our ministries, our homes, our marriages, so on and so forth.
Right.
If we really believe God and take Him at His word, Pastor Phil, that truth is truth, then we believe Romans chapter 8, verse 28, that God is working all things together for our good. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Our hearts are so valuable, yet they're so vulnerable. God wants our hearts. I want you to think about that.
Amen.
Yeah.
God wants our heart. He wants my heart as a pastor, as a minister, as a leader, as a husband, as a father. As a man of God, He wants my heart. In fact, God is jealous when someone else holds the key to my heart.
Right.
Sure He is.
Think about that. Mm-hmm. Pastor Jim said this morning, he would rather be in the presence of God than in the presence of his wife. How many understand our spouses want us to be in the presence of God?
Yes.
They don't want to have to deal with our flesh. Come on, somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Our wives, our children, our churches, our people need for us to have a heart after God. How many would say amen?
Amen.
But God is actually jealous when someone else holds the key to our heart. Look at this in Proverbs 23:26. My son, give me. Everybody say, give me.
Give me.
In other words, God's not going to take it from us.
Oh, that's good.
It's just like the scripture, present your body as a living sacrifice. Why? Because God's not going to take it from you. It's your choice. I love how he says that. My son, give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. Mm-hmm. You see, God wants our hearts because he knows when he gets our hearts, then he gets all of us. How many would say amen?
Yeah.
If he's got our hearts, he's got all of us. Mm-hmm. It's been said the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart.
That's right.
The heart of the matter is the matter of the heart, and how true that statement is. Again, I say our heart is so valuable, but yet it's so vulnerable. And if the breastplate is so important, and if it's only important for one reason, then it's important because it's guarding our most valuable asset, our heart. Because if our heart's not in it, then it's just a sham, a pretense, a clanking cymbal. We're just going through the motions. And I hate to say it, but we've all been there, haven't we? Our heart has to be in it. The breastplate is so important because it's guarding our heart from the fiery darts of the enemy. Does the devil fight anybody besides me? Does he come against you with distractions, discouragement? I hate to say it, even sometimes depression, Oh, let's be real here. Can we be honest?
Yeah.
Come on, it's just us. Let's take the mask off today. Boy, I'll tell you what, we fight a real enemy.
Yes, we do.
You know what?
Yes, we do.
You know what? He's a liar.
Yeah.
Every time the devil opens his mouth, every time the devil speaks, you know what's coming out? Lies. Deceit. Because he's the master deceiver.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
And I'm not trying to give him too much credit here this morning, but he's good at what he does.
Very.
And he doesn't hit us where we're strong, he hits us where we're weak.
Come on.
And how does he know our weakness? Because
yeah,
at some point in time in our walk, we've revealed our weakness to him. So he doesn't hit us where we're strong, he hits us where we're weak. The Bible says the devil is a roaring lion, goes about seeking whom he may devour.
Right.
Roaring lion goes about seeking whom he may devour. Right. But by the grace of God, I am not one of those whom he may devour. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Psalms 51, verse 10. Look at this. It says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Yeah.
Isn't that what Pastor Cook was talking about last night? Mm-hmm. Get your fire back. Get your spiritual groove back. Amen? Get your spiritual mojo back. Isn't that what convention is all about? Isn't that, how many understand revival is actually for the church?
Yeah.
We talk about revival sweeping the land. No, revival needs to sweep the church.
Yeah.
And then the church, a revived church, can, that can lead to a great spiritual awakening.
Yeah. Right. Amen.
I need revival. I need to live in a spirit of revival. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Our hearts need to be renewed. They need to be refreshed. They need to be kept. Remember that. The heart needs to be renewed, refreshed, and kept. They're not all ours, but it'll work anyway, right? Renewed, refreshed, and kept. Look at this in Philippians chapter 4, verse number 7. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep. Everybody say, shall keep. That's a good place to shout right there. Shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to know the devil's out to steal your peace.
Yes,
steal your joy.
That's right.
Why? Because the joy of the Lord is our
strength.
Strength.
Yeah.
In the natural, as a flesh and blood human being, our most valuable asset is our heart. We found that out the last 2 years with mom and dad and their health conditions. We can't live without our hearts. But as a child of God, we can say the very same thing about our spiritual heart. Jesus goes on to say this about our heart in John chapter 14, verse number 27. Peace I leave with you.
Right.
My peace I give unto you. How many are thankful for the peace of God?
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but the battle is in my mind.
Right.
That's where the battle is. Yeah. I'm so thankful that he said, peace I live with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not. There it is. That's up to us again. That's our part. Don't allow. Don't allow. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. How many understand being a child of God is what you make out of it?
Amen.
You put a little in, you're going to get a little out. But you put a whole lot in, you put your whole self in. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
What Carmen used to say, I'm sold out the whole route, completely born again. You know what? And if we're not living that, how do we expect our folks to live that?
Come on.
Amen?
Yeah, man.
I'm preaching to myself this morning, all right? You see, as a child of God, as a Christian, every day we must take the time, we must make the effort to put on the whole armor of God. Not just part, not just most, not just because we put it on years ago, but daily, put on the whole armor of God. Why? Because there's an enemy out there. He's watching us.
Yes, sir.
And he knows whether we've put it on or not. The Bible says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
Right. Yes, sir.
Mm. Look at your neighbor this morning and ask him, do you have your armor on? Did you leave the motel with your armor on this morning? Amen. We wouldn't think of leaving the house in the morning with no clothes on. At least I hope not. And yet so many Christians today are walking around with only some or none of the armor on. We think, well, I know what the Bible says. I'm saved, I'm sanctified, and what was that? Satisfied? Man, I preach. Waiting for Jesus to come. So many Christians today are walking around armorless. Armorless. The breastplate is part of the armor of God for a reason. It's not there to fill in the scripture, but it's there to serve a function.
That's great, brother.
It guards our most valuable asset.
Yes, sir.
Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. How many want to have a pure heart?
Amen.
Amen.
Oh my.
How many know as Christians, not only are we required to do the right thing, but we're required to do the right thing for the right reasons?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
We're not serving the Lord for the loaves and fishes. Come on, somebody.
Good preaching, brother.
We got a bunch of folk in our church that are hungry for more of God.
Yeah.
And want revival. They've been praying on Tuesday nights for what, probably the past year and a half. And I have chose not to lead them in this because I want to see how bad they want it. Everybody understand what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
But sometimes God will allow us to see things into the future and hear some things. How many's ever gotten a word from the Lord, but it looked totally opposite in the natural realm?
Oh, absolutely.
A promise about your future, a vision maybe, a thus saith the Lord, whatever. But we've got some good folk in our church that want to see revival and a great move of God. But how many know if you want to see God do great things, it's going to cost you something?
Amen.
It's going to cost you something. How many know everybody wants a calling, but nobody wants to be committed?
There's a price.
Mm-hmm. There's a price to pay. There's a price to pay. And it's a good thing to be hungry, but, you know, as leaders, we need to be hungry. We need to have a pure heart. Our motives need to be pure and clean and holy before the Lord. I ask these folks, we had a couple of them gathered for prayer, and I was at this prayer meeting, and I said this. I asked them, what if God never sends a great revival to this city, to this church? What if you never see a great outpouring of souls like you're asking for? And a couple of them kind of looked at me dumbfounded. And I said, will you still love God?
Yeah.
Will you still serve the Lord?
What a question.
And I wasn't trying to interject any doubt or fear or unbelief there. But how many know God is sovereign?
Amen. Oh, yes.
And if you're believing God for something and you're not seeing it, it's one of two things. It's either not His will or it's not His time.
Right.
And I don't know about you, but one of the things I find hard as a pastor is pastoring people.
Yeah.
Now that sounds funny, but how many know it's the truth? Because a lot of people just don't want to be pastored. They don't. Yeah, exactly. They won't let you. They have all this zeal. They have all this passion. And so I've been trying to deal with these folks in wisdom and in love. And how many know you have the folks who want God, and then you have the folks who just come and are content.
Yeah.
And you got to be a pastor to everyone. And it gets difficult sometimes. But our motives have to be pure and clean and holy. And so I've been trying to instill that into those. The peace of God that passes all understanding. I'm thankful for the peace of God. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Blessed are the pure in heart. I don't know about you, but I want a pure heart before the Lord.
Yes.
Now, I believe we're beginning to see the importance of the role of the heart here and how it comes into play, and more importantly, the importance of the breastplate and how it protects our heart. But quickly here, one more scripture before we kind of change directions here. In the Psalms, David said this in Psalms 19:14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the words of my heart, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Lord, help us just to meditate upon your word every day. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
You know, sometimes as pastors, we're looking for the latest gizmo and gadget, and I get it. I understand. And I'm all for technology. You know, we try all kinds of things. But can I say this? There's something to be said of the basics.
Come on.
There's something to be said of the basics. Going back to the heart of worship.
There you go.
What's that scripture? I should have looked it up. Seek out the old paths. Where is the good way? There's something to be said about our faces this morning. How many would say amen? Thank God that the Word and the Holy Spirit can keep our hearts in perfect peace. Can keep our hearts in good working condition. Now quickly, I want to just say a few words here about the rest of this piece of armor. It's called the breastplate of what? The breastplate of righteousness. And so the obvious question today then is this. What is righteousness? What is righteousness? Righteousness is simply being in a right standing with God. And being in a right standing with God is something that we can't do for ourselves. How many know Jesus came and did for us what we couldn't do for ourselves? Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Isaiah, look at this in Isaiah chapter 64, verse number 6. But we are all as an unclean thing. And all our righteousness are as what?
Filthy rags.
Filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf. And our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. So even on our best day, we don't measure up on God's righteous meter. How many would say amen?
Amen.
Even though God deserves our best, yet our best is never good enough. And that's why Jesus came. Can somebody say praise the Lord?
Yeah.
That's what Easter, that's what Resurrection Sunday is all about.
Yeah.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 21. For He has made Him to be sin for us. Oh, this is a good place to shout right now. Who knew no sin, that we may might be made the righteousness of God in Him. Can you say praise the Lord?
Amen.
Since our righteousness wasn't good enough, God had to impute His own righteousness to us. He gave us this thing called the law. We quickly figured out that we couldn't fulfill that. Jesus came and He said, well, you know what? I didn't come to do away with it. I come to fulfill it for you. How many are thankful for a better covenant?
Amen.
How many are thankful you don't live under the law, but you live under grace?
Amen.
Now listen, I'm not a hyper-grace fan. I don't believe grace is a license to go out and do whatever you want to do. In fact, how many understand really the true revelation of grace is this? It's the enabling factor not to sin.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Grace just isn't an eraser and said, well, you know, I'm going to erase everything.
Yeah.
No, grace is the enabling factor not to sin.
Right. Amen.
That's the truth of grace.
Amen.
For He has made Him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we may be made the righteousness of God in Him.
Yeah.
Even on our best day, we're still not good enough. But thank God He's imputed His own righteousness to us. When somebody say praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
But now, let me say this. Righteousness isn't the same thing as holiness. Righteousness isn't the same thing as holiness. And let me give you a little saying here or a formula that might help us to decipher the difference between the two. Righteousness is what God does for us, but holiness is what we do for Him.
Come on.
Righteousness is what God does for us, but holiness is what we do for Him. As human beings, we cannot be righteous enough for God. And that's why He gave us His righteousness. But on the other hand, we can be holy.
Yeah.
I said we can be holy.
Amen.
1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 16 says this, because it is written. Everybody say written.
Written.
So that means it's absolute truth, right? How many believe the Word of God's absolute truth?
Amen.
From Genesis to Revelation. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God.
Amen.
Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. But there's an exception to every rule. No, it doesn't say that.
No.
No, we don't add to or take away from the Word, do we?
Come on.
Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy, period. Period.
Yeah.
The question is, what part of that don't we understand? Mm-hmm. We live in a society, we live in a day and age where anything and everything goes, right?
Yeah.
There's no absolutes. Mm-hmm. If it feels good, do it.
Yeah.
And the sad thing about it is that mentality is creeping more and more into the church.
Yes, sir.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 14. Follow peace with all men.
Yeah.
And what?
Holiness.
Holiness. Without which,
no man.
No I shall see the Lord. Does your Bible say that?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm old school. I got the King James here this morning. I usually preach out of the New King James, but I got the King James version this morning.
It says the same.
Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord.
Amen.
See the Lord. Now there's a message no one wants to preach anymore. The message of holiness. And I'm not talking about the length of your skirt or your shirt or your hair, but just holiness. If we can say it, I don't mean this in a disrespectful way, but just generic holiness. What does it mean to be holy? We don't want to preach it anymore, and the reason why we don't want to preach it anymore is because nobody wants to hear it. Well, Pastor, we live in a society, we live in a day, an age where we're all evolving.
Thanks, James.
Oh, yeah. I hate that word, evolving. My Bible says God never changes.
Never.
He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore the same.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Come on.
Amen.
So we don't preach holiness anymore because nobody wants to hear. The Word of God warned us about this. The Bible says there would come a day when they wouldn't even endure sound doctrine. Let's look at it real quick here in 2 Timothy. Chapter 4, verse number 3 and 4. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth. There it is. We heard about the truth this morning. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables.
Amen.
But you see, it's not just doctrine anymore. It's not just the Logos or the written Word of God that's been compromised. But now it's the Rhema or the spoken Word of God that has been compromised as well. Why? Because everybody's a prophet today. And don't get me wrong, I believe in the fivefold ministry. Come on, somebody. The prophet is important. But this day, everybody has a thus saith the Lord. Hey, you know what? You want a word? Here it is,
there
right here.
Go.
Get in.
Hey.
Here's your word. Here's your sign.
Hey.
Amen?
Yes.
Right on.
I believe in the reign of the spoken word of God. But it can be compromised just as like the Logos is being compromised in so many churches today.
Right.
How many know we have a standard to uphold?
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Those pioneers of the faith who have blazed the trail before us, and if many have given their life, why should we just take the gospel and just water it down now? For whatever reason. To be liked, to fill pews, to fill seats. No, we've got to stand for the truth. How many would say we've got to stand for the truth?
Amen.
We can't compromise.
Stand their head up.
In closing, look at this. We go back to the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. Chapter 30, verses 9 and 10. That this is a rebellious people.
Yeah.
Lying children. Children that will not hear the law of the Lord. Now, this is Old Testament. This is the prophet speaking. That this is a rebellious people, lying children. Children that will not hear the law of the Lord.
Yeah.
Which say to the seers, see not. And to the prophets, they don't say don't prophesy at all. But what they say is prophesy not unto us right things.
Yeah.
But speak unto us
smooth things.
Wow.
There's a lot of that going on.
Smooth things.
Yeah.
Prophesy deceits. In other words, I would rather you prophesy something good to me.
Yeah. Good.
Than to tell me where I'm messing up.
Come on.
Yeah.
Where I need God.
Yeah.
Where I need a little rebuke.
Yeah.
Like we received last night. In a good way. In a loving way.
Sure.
How many know every once in a while we need to hear the truth preached?
Amen. Amen. Got to hear.
Just every once in a while we need to put a little truth in there, don't we?
Yeah.
Right. I need a little facetious there, but I think you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I think we all know that this verse describes the day and age in which we live. I'm not trying to be Debbie Downer. I'm not trying to be Negative Nancy here. I believe in positive. I believe in faith. I believe in speaking life and not death. Blessing and not cursing. But you know, there's some things that we just can't compromise on.
Come on. That's right. Come on.
Absolutely.
You know what? And if you this is what I've learned. If you compromise here, then you're going to compromise there.
Yes,
And if you compromise to fill that seat, then you're going to have to compromise to fill this seat. So you know what we do? We just don't compromise at all. We preach the truth in love. We love people, and we just leave the rest up to God.
Come on. Amen.
But I know what happens as ministers, and I don't. I know this never happens to you, but we take things personally, don't we?
Oh, yeah.
We work so hard for Sunday morning. We pray, we fast, we preach, we study, we prepare, we clean toilets, we do this, we do that. There ain't no preachers in the house ever mow the yard or clean the toilet.
Amen. Yeah.
All right. All right.
Yeah.
We had an evangelist family at our church not too long ago, and they were there for a while. And so they were there for some of our activities and get-togethers and food. And my wife and I, you know, we might not be the greatest leaders, but we always lead by example. And we'll eat, we'll fellowship, but then at a certain time, we'll get up and we'll start cleaning up.
Sure.
And the evangelist's wife, she said, well, you need to get a cleaning crew. It's like, well, guess what? You're looking at the cleaning crew.
Yeah.
And you might disagree with me on that or not, you know, but hey, it is what it is. Yeah. I believe we need to be willing to do anything and everything.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
And a great leader, I don't think is a... I know I need to be a better delegator, but I think a great leader is one that leads by example.
Absolutely.
Come on.
Leads by example. Amen.
Yeah.
You just don't do what I say, but I'm going to get in there and we're going to do it. Amen.
Yeah.
Pastors, evangelists, missionaries, can I tell you that we have our work cut out for us?
Yeah.
We're living in perilous times. It's the last of the last days.
Come on.
I believe what we do, we must do quickly. We must be busy about our Father's business. And one thing I really sense is this. We have to keep our focus.
Right.
We have to keep our eyes unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the all.
Yeah.
We have to keep our eyes unto Jesus, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our
faith. Sure, come on.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says it's the little foxes that spoil the lion.
Right. Oh,
yeah.
And this is one thing I find out. I work full time, and then we pastor. And this is one of the greatest attacks of the enemy in my life. It is not just time, finding enough time for everything, but distractions.
Yeah.
Distractions. And it's not always bad things. It can be good things.
Right.
And the Bible addresses this. Don't be overcharged with sobriety.
Yeah.
And excessiveness and making a living and working and doing this and doing that.
Hear it. Yeah.
But don't forget what you're called to do.
That's it.
Amen.
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 Is your heart in it?
Right, man.
Is your heart in it? Mm. And you know what? Just like Pastor Cook said last night, sometimes my heart needs to be renewed. It needs to be refreshed.
Amen.
Because I'm human and I get frustrated. How many get stressed out from time to time?
Yeah,
that's right. Amen? You know, I'll say this and then I'll quit. Dad came to Lincoln, 1977. He quit the best job he ever had, working at State Farm to go full-time in the ministry. And so, to make a long story short, I was 8 years old when Dad started at the church in Lincoln. And I felt the call of God in my life at an early age. I ran from it, and then eventually surrendered. My wife and I, we've worked in the church and been faithful and so on and so forth. And then 6 years ago, it was kind of hard because we grew up in the church. We did a little bit of everything. My wife, she taught Sunday school. I played the drums. I led worship from the drums. We were youth pastors for several years. We associate pastor. And as the time was coming for the transition, it was hard because, you know, working with Dad, I didn't want to push him out, and he didn't want to push me in. He didn't want to make me do anything I wasn't ready to do. And so, Brother Jerry, it was hard sometimes because I respected him so much and his ministry. But as the year 2011 was nearing, we both knew that the time was coming. And so we got together and we made an agreement about that and so on and so forth. But can I just say this? Ministry can be so hard. Ministry can be so hard.
I didn't know that.
You didn't know that, did you, Pastor? I just busted your bubble right there. Let all the air out. But you know what? In the midst of every struggle, with every test.
There you are.
With every
come on,
God always proves He's so faithful.
He does.
Always proves
Himself
faithful. And you know what? He does. He allows us to be pushed to our limitations. And the reason why I believe He allows that is because He wants us to turn to Him. He wants us to have a breakdown. Is that all right? I remember what Pastor W.B. Badger used to say, come apart before you come apart. And how many know as pastors, especially as men, we try to hold things together. We try to work things out. You know? Sometimes you got to just step back and say, God, do this. I can't do this. The Bible says something like this, unless God builds the house,
they who labor, labor in vain.
Right. And we know this isn't the church. The church isn't its timbers, it's its members.
That's it.
That's good.
Let me finish by saying this. Whatever you're believing God for, it might feel like you're in the valley of those dead dry bones of Ezekiel chapter 37. But let God breathe a fresh breath over them again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Let God. He says, I will work, but who will let?
Exactly.
Let God breathe upon you afresh and anew. Quickly, let me finish my story. I'm like my dad. I'm on a bunch of rabbit trails here. Let me finish my story here, though. I would look at Dad, and I would always feel in fear. I thought, you know, he was willing to quit his job at State Farm and go full-time into the ministry. 2011, the church made us, you know, an offer to go full-time as pastors. And I'm like, you know, I think I really need to stay on with the state of Illinois. I have, at the time, I would have had 8 years before I could retire. Thank the Lord I only have 2 now. Can somebody say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
And I said, let me try to do both of these jobs. I can be such a blessing financially to the church, you know, and in 8 years I'll be fully invested, retired, I'll be able to walk out. And so I always had that kind of hanging over my head of that I never took the plunge. I never took that leap of faith like Dad did by leaving his secular job. Well, in the last couple of years, the Lord has spoke to my spirit and revealed something to me. One day I was studying and I was kind of thinking about this. And because let me say this, when you don't have to be in ministry, it makes it really tough. Does anybody know where I'm going with this?
Oh, yeah.
I don't have to pastor.
Don't have to put up.
I have a very good job. I stay well. It pays my bills. Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Illinois is broke.
Illinois is broke, but I'm getting an IOU right now.
But I've been there, done that. Yeah.
My secular job pays my bills. It takes care of me. It allows me to give my tithes and offerings, so on and so forth. And so what the Lord spoke to me one time in my study was this. And when it did, it was such a relief. I was like, thank you, Lord, I needed that. What I have found out, what the Lord has showed me, is it has took greater faith to stay when I didn't have to stay.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
When I know that I'm there for the right reasons.
That's
no,
right.
I might not be perfect, but I'm there for the right reasons.
That's
come on, somebody.
Right. Amen. Yeah.
And so isn't that awesome how God always knows exactly what we need, exactly when we need it?
Yeah.
And so I'm just sharing that with you. But I close today with this, the breastplate of righteousness.
Yeah.
And I say this, don't compromise the breastplate.
Rise it.
Because if the breastplate is compromised, the heart is left unprotected.
Right. That's it.